My name is George Ayite, and I am currently the president of the Free Africa Foundation. Many people believe that traditional African economies are inherently socialist, people who put group or tribal identities ahead of the individual. This has led to the belief that the socialist economic models are inherently African. But is traditional African culture inherently socialist? To understand this question, it is imperative to understand the rise of socialism in Africa. Contrary to what many people believe, socialism was never part of indigenous African societies. In fact, it was a response to colonialism and a fight for independence. Many fighters for political independence mistakenly equated colonialism with capitalism. And for that reason, the rise was an ideology which they saw as radically different from what they had experienced under colonialism. Political leaders such as Julius Nyerere of Tanzania, Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Kenneth Kaunda of Zambia embraced socialism and worked deliberately to establish models of government based on socialist ideology. Unfortunately, socialism in Africa, just like socialism elsewhere in the world, has created enormous poverty while fostering dictatorship, corruption, and violence, nationalized ownership of industry and resources, and strict control of government's assets over individual economic activity is the biggest cause of high levels of poverty in Africa. However, contrary to what many people believe, totalitarian socialism is not inherently African, nor does it arise from traditional African culture. In the West, the basic economic and social unit is the individual. The American says, "I am because I am." In Africa, the basic economic and social unit is the extended family. The African says, "I am because we are." When the first European came to Africa and asked, "Whom does this land belong to?" the African said, "The land belongs to us." This is how the myth of communal ownership of land arose. Land and resources were not owned by tribal governments, but by extended families, working freely with each other without government control. It is important to emphasize that no traditional government could dictate to an African what crops to grow on his farm, where to take his harvest to sell, and how much he should charge. On Africa's free village markets, prices are determined by bargaining, not fixed by traditional authorities. Nor could they tell Africans what type of occupation they should enter into. Africans could become hunters, fishermen, farmers, musicians, or whatever that they wanted to become. Free enterprise was the rule, and free trade routes like the Trans-Saharan crisscrossed the continent before the white colonialists arrived. Government has been responsible for retrogressing Africa's development. This has led to terrible consequences for Africa. Africa's salvation lies in returning to and building upon its own indigenous institutions. Botswana is the only African country which did this, which is why Botswana is doing very well. This also proves that the solutions to Africa's problems do not lie inside the corridors of the US Congress or the World Bank, nor do they lie inside the inner sanctum of the Chinese Presidium. They lie in Africa itself.